Good morning, students, and welcome to lesson number 2 on the topic volcanoes. I am Mrs. Francis from CV Bethel Senior High School, and I will be your instructor for today's lesson. I am going to play a song for you guys. Now, what I want you to do is listen to the words of the song, and I want you to answer these 4 questions. Remember, you're gonna get the answers from the song. So I'm going to give you 2 minutes to write the questions. So, you should have already written down these 4 questions. Number 1, name the area where most volcanoes are formed. 2, list 3 parts of a volcano mentioned in the song. 4, which volcanoes are wide? And 4, which volcanoes have alternating layers? The purpose of this exercise is for us to review some of the concepts that were taught in yesterday's lesson, as well as introduce new concepts that we will learn in today's lesson. So let's begin.
Change over time, alternating flow.
hope you have the answers to those four questions. So, name the area where most volcanoes, the Ring of Fire, yes, Essen. The majority of volcanoes are found in an area known as that as well. Next, list three parts of a volcano that were mentioned in the song. Type your answer. I see that you've said eruption. Remember now, when we talk about the parts of the volcano, we're talking about those parts that you would see. So not eruption, try again. Oh, three parts of the volcano mentioned in the song are the chamber, what is known as the magma chamber. Yes, the pipe, the vent. Yes, you heard about the crater. Excellent job, guys. Now, number three, which volcanoes are wide? Which volcanoes are wide? Oh, DeLon, you're on a roll. Yes, I see you have the answer there. Who else has the answer? Which volcanoes are wide? Malcolm, try again. It's not the answer that you have there. Yes, Taylor, yes. Good, great job. Most of you have the answer correct. The volcanoes mentioned in the song that are considered wide are your shield volcanoes. Yes, your shield volcanoes. And number four, which volcanoes mentioned in the song have alternating layers? Type your answers in the chat. Number four, which volcanoes have alternating layers? DeLon says composite, and he is correct. Composite volcanoes, yes, Kareem, you've got it correct as well. Composite volcanoes, or they're also called stratovolcanoes, have alternating layers. So we reviewed some concepts that were taught yesterday, and I introduced you to some new concepts in the song that we will be covering in today's lesson. So let's begin by looking at our objectives. Objective number one, we would like to identify the main types of volcanoes. Number two, discuss the characteristics of these three types. And number three, we are going to compare intrusive volcanic features to extrusive volcanic features. So, types of volcanoes. Question, can you name the three types of volcanoes based on their shape? Please type your three types of volcanoes based on their shape. I see you guys are taking a minute to think about this. All right, so the three types of volcanoes based on shape are as follows. One, we have strato, or what we said, composite volcanoes. Two, we have shield volcanoes. Yes, I see you guys have the answers. They're coming in. Great job, Samuel. Good job, DeLon. And we also have the ash and cinder cone volcanoes. So remember, based on the volcano shape, okay, we have three main types. Stratovolcanoes, which are also known as composite volcanoes, shield volcanoes, and we have ash and cinder cone volcanoes. So we're going to look at each of these individually, and we're going to look at their characteristics as well. So let's begin with the stratovolcano. Now, this is a beautiful picture here of Mount St. Helens. And Mount St. Helens is a strato or composite volcano. Now, I want you guys to think about the word stratovolcano. If you've never heard of that before, you can still figure out some of the characteristics of this volcano just by examining the word stratovolcano. Remember, when you're trying to figure out the definitions of words, you can do that by looking at the base word or the root word. If the word has a prefix, you can also look at the prefix of the word or the suffix. Well, this word, stratovolcano, has a prefix, strato. What do you think that prefix means? Because that will give you an idea of what this volcano looks like. Malcolm, you said space. No, let's try again. Think about words that have the prefix strato in it. So what do you think that would mean? Stratosphere, right? Stratovolcano. Oh, Joelle said tall and high. You're getting closer. Good try. Who else wants to try before I tell you? Go ahead and type your answer in the chat. Okay, awesome, DeLon. Yes, you hit the nail on the head. Strato means layers, okay? It means layers. Very good. Yes, Kareem, you got it correct as well. So stratovolcanoes are made up of alternating layers. Very good. So here you see a picture of, or sorry, a diagram, pardon me, of Mount St. Helens, which is a strato, or like we said, a composite volcano. So notice that this volcano has alternate layers. You can see a layer of lava, and then you can see a layer of ash. So over time, when this volcano erupts, you will have it being built up of alternating layers of ash and lava. And this type of volcano is the one that most people will see when they watch movies. So when you see a Hollywood movie and they show you a volcano, most of the time, the one that you're seeing is a stratovolcano or a composite volcano. So if you've watched the movie Dante's Peak or the movie Pompeii, those erupting volcanoes that were in those movies, those were stratovolcanoes or composite volcanoes, okay? Now, with these types of volcanoes, when they erupt violently, explosively. And so what happens is the top of the volcano, the crater, that is usually blown off. When that happens, the top collapses into the vent, creating a larger or a wider opening at the top of the volcano. And then the name changes from crater to a feature called a caldera, all right? So that is your composite cone volcano or your stratovolcano. Now, what are the characteristics of stratovolcanoes? Type your answers in the chat. Remember, when we talk about characteristics, we're talking about the features of something. So what would be the features of stratovolcanoes? How would you recognize them? Very good, Malcolm. Yes, they have layers. What else? What else would you say is a characteristic of a stratovolcano? I say Joelle said that they're wide. Well, they're not too wide. Oh, DeLon, yes. You said these volcanoes are characterized by having a steep profile. Excellent, yes. And they have explosive eruptions. Very, very good, yes. Oh, Malcolm, yes, they erupt violently. Very good. And Naisha, yes, they have thick lava. Very good, Kareem. Yes, multiple layers. Oh, you guys are so sharp today. You're on a roll. Excellent job. So yes, all of what you said is correct. The characteristics of stratovolcanoes are: one, they're built up of alternate layers of ash and lava. Two, they erupt with great violence. They're very explosive. It's almost like a bomb going off when these volcanoes erupt. C, they're found at disruptive, or what we call compressional plate boundaries. And D, they are steep-sided. Yes, excellent job. Excellent job, students. You are all doing very, very well today. So proud of you. Now, I am showing you here examples of stratovolcanoes. So previously, you saw on the slide Mount St. Helens. So we said that that is a stratovolcano. It is found in the United States. Other examples of stratovolcanoes include Krakatoa, as well as Mount Rainier, which is also in the United States. Now, I want to show you a short video clip of the eruption of a stratovolcano.
Costa Rica's Turrialba volcano erupted also last year. No one was reported to have been killed, but nearby airports and facilities had to be shut down for days until the ash subsided.
Much ash came out of that eruption. So you can see that these volcanoes erupt violently. Now,
Costa Rica's
shield volcanoes. The photograph that you're viewing shows you an example of a shield volcano. All right? This is Mauna Loa, found in the Hawaiian Islands. In fact, most of the volcanoes in the Hawaiian Islands are shield volcanoes. All right, so let's look at the diagram of a shield volcano. Notice the base or the diameter of the volcano. It is characterized by having a wide base. Notice also that it is not as tall as the composite or stratovolcano. And here you see in the diagram that it is built up of layers of lava flow. So this is your shield volcano. Now, what are the characteristic features of shield volcanoes? Please type your answers in the chat for me. Yes, Malcolm, very good. They are low or not very high. Excellent, Joelle. Layers of lava, yes, Delon. They have shallow in slopes or sides. Excellent, very good. Samuel, they are not very steep. Very good, Kareem. They spread out along the surfaces. Excellent job, students, excellent job. So, characteristics of shield volcanoes. A, they build up from layers of lava. B, they usually erupt quietly. So when they erupt, there's no loud explosion, there's no violence. The lava just simply pours out of the volcano. Yes, see, they are low and gently sloping, hence their wide base. Excellent job. And D, they're found at constructive or tensional boundaries. Very good, students. You all have a good grasp of the characteristics of shield volcanoes. Now, this is a photograph showing you an ash and cinder cone volcano. In fact, it is a picture of Mount Paracutin, which is in Mexico. This is an example of a cinder cone volcano. So let's look at this diagram. Notice that the cinder cone volcano, it is more symmetrical than the other two volcanoes. And in fact, cinder cones are more common than stratovolcanoes and shield volcanoes, okay? So when you think of a volcano, most of the time, when you think of that symmetrical volcano, you're picturing in your mind the ash and cinder cone volcano. Additionally, cinder cone volcanoes, they can occur by themselves as single volcanoes, or they can sometimes appear on the side of stratovolcanoes or shield volcanoes. When they appear on the side of these two other volcanoes, they are considered to be secondary cones or parasitic cones. Okay? So that's the ash and cinder cone volcanoes. And their characteristics, A, they're built up of layers of ash and cinders, and they erupt with great violence, with a great explosion, similar to the stratovolcano. Volcanic features. When we think about volcanoes, we need to remember that volcanoes can have intrusive volcanic features and volcanoes can have extrusive volcanic features. Intrusive volcanic features are located inside of the volcano. Again, look at the word intrusive. See that prefix in? It refers to internal or inside. So internal or intrusive volcanic features are located inside of the volcano or beneath the Earth's crust. Examples of these features will include the sill, the dike, the laccolith, and the batholith. Okay, those are all examples of intrusive volcanic features. Extrusive volcanic features, on the other hand, are located outside of the volcano, outside of the Earth's crust. So extrusive, meaning exit. So these are the features that are formed when magma exit the volcano. So these will include the volcanic cone, the volcano itself, lava flow, or lava plateaus. So you see a diagram here of some intrusive volcanic features. Notice that all of the orangey red layers are showing you features found below the surface of the Earth. So look at the arrows pointing to all of those volcanic rock features found intrusively beneath the Earth's surface. This diagram shows you all of the ones that I mentioned previously. So notice the batholith. It is a huge volcanic feature, intrusive volcanic feature found deep below the volcano, below the Earth's surface. Then you can see the laccolith, and then you can also see the dike, as well as the sill, okay? These are all intrusive volcanic features. And remember, students, intrusive volcanic features have very large crystals, okay? And that is because the magma flowing beneath the surface of the Earth, it takes a long time to cool. When that magma cools, it then solidifies or hardens into rock. And so the crystals inside of the rock tend to be very large. When these intrusive features become exposed, in other words, when the rock layers above them are worn and eroded, they can be seen. They're exposed at the surface. When you look at them, you will notice that you are able to see the crystals in the rock because they are large. So you don't need a microscope to see them. All right, you can see them with the naked eye. So let's look at how we are going to identify these features. So the sill, it says this is formed when a sheet of magma lies horizontally along the bedding plane of sedimentary rocks. So when you are looking at a diagram showing you intrusive volcanic features, remember that the sill is the sheet of magma that hardens horizontally, okay? Horizontally, so you're going to look for it horizontally between the layers of rock. So those are your keywords, right? Horizontally, as well as a sheet, it's flat, a sheet of magma. Then we have the dike. How will you recognize the dike? This is formed when a mass of magma cuts vertically. What does vertically mean? Upright, okay? So when a mass of magma cuts vertically across the bedding planes of rocks, and these rocks are usually sedimentary because they allow the magma to move in between the spaces of the rock. So when a mass of magma cuts vertically upright, that feature that is formed is a dike, okay? So it's similar to a wall-like feature. It's like a boulder, all right? An igneous mound, which is shaped like a dome. The magma which forms the laccolith is formed in the upper surface. So it's closer to the surface. And then we have the batholith. The batholith is a larger feature, intrusive feature, and it's basically the root of the mountain. And batholiths are commonly granite because they are intrusive. And they're exposed to the surface by erosion of overlapping rocks. Now, our extrusive volcanic features, the ones that we see above the surface, what are they? This diagram shows you the volcano itself, the volcanic cone, as well as lava flows. So here you see extrusive volcanic features. So you have the volcano or the volcanic cone that you can see above the Earth's surface, and then you can have lava flows or lava platforms, all right? So the volcanic cone, it's triangular shape, as you saw in the photograph previously, and it's a hill or a mountain formed as material from volcanic eruptions pile up around the vent or that opening that's in the center of the volcano. And of course, the lava flow is simply the outpouring of lava, remember liquid rock, created during a non-explosive eruption. Now guys, let's review. In fact, I shouldn't say guys because we have ladies there. So now ladies and gentlemen, let's review. Saw these riddles, you know from yesterday's lesson, Mrs. Francis loves riddles. So, saw these riddles, and I want you to type your answers in the chat. One, this can create dark clouds, but they don't contain snow. Beware of falling ash and the hot lava flow. What am I? Type your answers in the chat. Joelle, a stratovolcano, no. Take another guess. Malcolm says a shield volcano, no. DeLon says a cinder cone volcano. No, I think you guys are thinking a little too deep here. It is an ash cloud, an ash cloud. That's okay. Let's try number two. Let's try number two. All right. Type your answers in the chat for number two. It says, there was one of these called Krakatoa, keyword, which erupted in 1883. It was heard 3,000 miles away and was one of the worst in history. So what am I? What am I? Type your answers in the chat for number two. So put number two so I can know what your answer is. Oh, Joelle says, cinder cone volcano. Matthew says, a stratovolcano. DeLon says, a stratovolcano. Yes, you guys got it right. Give yourselves a round of applause or a pat on the back. Awesome job, students. Three, we are found in darkness beneath the earth. It takes a long time to see our birth. What are we? Type your answers in the chat for number three, please. Oh, Malcolm, you said intrusive volcanic features. Excellent job, excellent job. Yes, did you see the keywords? Formed in darkness beneath the earth? And it takes a long time, that's right, it takes millions of years before these features are ever seen. So yes, we are intrusive volcanic features. Very good, yes, DeLon, you said you were thinking of that, exactly. Now let's look at riddle four. I want you to type your answers in the chat for me. It says, I am low and wide, but cannot hide. A warrior's friend. I need lots of ashes to mend. Ah, Malcolm is right on the button. Yes, Malcolm says a shield volcano. DeLon says an extrusive volcano. Naisha says a shield volcano. And Joelle says a shield volcano. Well, guys, the answer is ash and cinder cone volcano. No, I am sorry. You are correct. You are correct. A shield volcano. Yes. A warrior's friend. That was my mistake, a typo. So you see, you guys were paying attention. You caught that little error there. But it was, you are correct. It was a shield volcano. The key words, a warrior's friend. Shield volcanoes are wide, students. And they are representative of a warrior's shield. Excellent job. You all were fabulous today. Let's review the assignments that you have to complete that you can do in your spare time. I would like you to build a 3D model, your own 3D model of a volcano. Now, I know that we are all at home in isolation trying to stay safe, so I don't want you to stress about doing this activity. What I want you to do is I want you to think out of the box. I want you to use whatever materials you have at home to construct a 3D model of a volcano. You guys can do it. You are wonderful, creative students. So once you have constructed your 3D model, you can post it, if you are able to the website for me to see. So please complete the worksheets, and I would like you to construct the 3D model of your volcano. Students, that is the end of today's lesson. You all have been fantastic.
Hello, students, and welcome to another wonderful day to learn something new in social studies with me, Mrs. Monker. Today, we will be reviewing a few lessons on map skills. If you're ready, Let's get started. Lesson 1. Map scales. At the end of this lesson, students should be able to 1. Define and explain the purpose of map scales. 2. Identify 3 different types of map scales. And 3. Demonstrate the use of linear and bar scales. This sounds exciting already. What is a map scale? A map scale is the ratio between 2 sets of measurements. A scale helps us take real-life distances and measurements and fit them in a much smaller space. What is its purpose? Well, simply this. Map scales help you to measure distances on a map. It helps to measure the distance from one point to an X. 3 types of scales you should know are as follows. Number 1, word scale. Word scale uses words to show the relationship between map distances and real life distances. Example, 1 inch equals 10 miles. Number 2, representative fraction. These are fractions that show relationship between map distances and real life distances. Number 3, linear or bar scale. These may use a line or bar to show the relationship between map distances and real life distances, as shown in the example. Just in case you're wondering how to use a linear or bar scale, stick with me and you will find out. Now you will need a few things. Item number 1, a strip of paper. Item number 2, a pencil. And item number 3, a map of the Bahamas found in one of your past BJC booklets. This is a perfect time to pause this video so that you will have all the things you need. Now, let's get started. As you can see on this map of the Bahamas, each island has a black dot. The dot represent main settlements. When we are measuring, we measure from dot to dot or point to point. This helps with accuracy when we are measuring one point to the next. Let's watch a quick demonstration. Pay close attention. Okay, so we want to measure the distance from one point to the next. This here is in Andros, this here is Nicholstown, and this here is Governor's Harbor. So if I want to measure the distance between Nicholstown, Governor's Harbor, I must use the scale that's given to me on the map. Here, you have miles. Here, you have kilometers. Let's just say the question asks for you to give it in miles. So your first point is to get a paper. Okay, now that we have our paper, now it's time for us to do the measurements. So we'll take our pencil and we'll mark where it says 0. We'll mark where it says 25. Mark where it says 50. Mark where it says 75. Mark where it says 100. Mark where it says 125. That's your second point. The third point is now we want to label. So that's 0, that's 25, 50, 75, 100, 125. And if you can guess or look carefully, it's counting in 25s. All right?
So now at least we have the first plot. That's your step two. So now we're ready for step three. Step three is now we're going to take the paper and we're going to put line up the point zero to the point where, or the dot that's on the island of Andros, Nichols Town. And we're going to try to line up the next part of the paper here on the dot where it is Governor's Harbor. So as you can see, this is the zero is lined up already. Let's pull the paper down just a little bit, just a quick slant. Have to do some adjustment very quickly. I'm trying to do this with one hand because I'm holding the phone with the next. The distance in miles between Governor's Harbor, Eleuthera, and Nichols Town, Andros, can possibly be 100 and maybe 10 to 115 miles.
What will happen if you have to measure the distance between one place and another, but the scale given is too short? For example, let's measure the distance between Nassau on New Providence and Coburn Town on San Salvador. If you notice, the scale stops at 125, but there is still some distance to go. You can take the paper back down to the scale and line up the 125 with the zero. Add 25 at each point. Remember, we are counting in 25s. Continue along until you get to the end, making sure that everything is lined up with the points. Now let's measure. Line up the zero with Nassau and continue along. Now we can say that the distance between Nassau and Coburn Town is 200 miles. Let's see if you understood the demonstration. It's time for independent practice. Use the map of the Bahamas from any past BJC booklet to find the directions of the following. Number one, Freeport, Grand Bahama to Nassau, New Providence in miles. Number two, Georgetown, Exuma to Arthurstown, Cat Island. And number three, Spring Point, Acklands to Matthewtown, Inagua. This is a perfect opportunity to pause this video as you work independently. I am certain you did a super job. Did you get the same answers as I did? Check the answers below. Remember, the answers may be estimated. Thumbs up. I hope you had a wonderful time learning social studies with me. Remember to study smart and not hard. I'll see you soon.